What's up, YouTube? Once again, you're in the kitchen with Paul. Today, what we're going to do is the barber. Wow.
Let me stop it.
No, don't stop it. This is why the butcher is open. So we went to the butcher, and as you can hear, we got my little puppies, my little nephews in the background.
You're not your nephews,
your grandpuppies. My grandpuppy, excuse me. They're in the background and they're doing their little thing. But what we got is we got some oxtails. We haven't had oxtails in a long time. So me and my baby girl, we're going to do some oxtails. I want to bring her into the camera right now.
Hi, YouTube. I'm Shayna, also known as Baby Girl. But you can also find me on WordPress on More or Less, where I am a writer. And I am recently submitting some pieces where you can go and get some encouragement, some healing, all of that. So today, the reason why I am featuring on this lovely episode of In the Kitchen with Paul is we are going to talk about black father and daughter relationships and their significance. Ooh.
Little something for y'all. But we're going to get things started, and we're going to get it started right now. What's up, YouTube? Once again, you're in the kitchen with Paul. What? What's up, YouTube? What's up, YouTube? Once again, you're in the kitchen with Paul. Once again. Okay, YouTube. What we got here is we're gonna start with green pepper, onion, red pepper. We got some garlic. We got some baby Bella mushrooms. We got salt and pepper, some paprika, onion powder, garlic powder, and some olive oil. These are our ingredients to get started, and what we're going to do is we're going to get started chopping all this stuff up. We're going to have to clean our oxtails up. But look at the size of these oxtails. Look at the size of that piece right there. That's a good looking oxtail. Ooh-wee! Yes, sir. Alright, the first thing that we have to do is we have to clean our oxtails. So we gotta get these out of the bag. I'm putting them in a nice big bowl. First thing we have to do is we have to wash them off. Cold water. You know, in this time of COVID, you don't know what's out there. So you gotta make sure that you wash all your meats, all your vegetables. Get all that excess stuff off of them. Get some vinegar out. Of course, I go to BJ's and Sam's Club, so I get the big one. Fill this up with water, swirl them around. Alright, we haven't done this in a while. I had a little technical difficulties with the new tripod that I'm using. It's called a gimbal, but that's neither here nor there. You want to soak your oxtails in cold water with some vinegar in it. Okay, and that's going to take all of this red bloody water. It's going to take all of this out of there. You want to make sure your oxtails are nice and clean. But also, you want to take all of this extra fat off of your oxtails. Okay, you don't want to eat all that fat. Okay, and it's not going to render down. And when I say render down, that means it's not going to melt. All of this fat is not going to melt away. So you have to cut some of that away. You leave some fat on there because fat is flavor. Okay. As one of the other guys said, if fat was flavor, I'm delicious. But yeah, you take some of that fat off of there. So we're gonna trim these down a little bit, but we also have to cut up our vegetables. Okay, YouTube, while we're cleaning off these oxtails, I wanted to build with my daughter a little bit. And she went to school at Morgan State University.
Wait, Dad, you have to say it correctly. The Morgan State University in Baltimore, Maryland.
Excuse me.
The orange and the blue.
Mm.
Thank you.
All of that, yeah. And then, after she got her bachelor's, why don't you tell them about the rest of your credentials there, huh?
So, I went to Morgan State and I received my bachelor's in science and psychology. I came home to New Jersey and my first job was Forever 21, fresh out of college. And I said, this ain't it at all. So I decided to pick back up and move back to Maryland and go to grad school, to my parents' dismay, because they're like, you just came back. But I went back to Maryland and I entered grad school, where I received my Master's of Arts in Clinical Mental Health Counseling. And I have a focus in trauma-informed therapy as well as cognitive behavioral therapy. So which in that, I decided to use my blog to try to process and work through my own trauma, especially my own childhood trauma. And now with that, I pitched the idea to my dad, like, hey, you have a YouTube platform. Why don't I feature in and we can just kind of talk about some things, mainly black fathers and black daughters, because I truly do cherish my relationship with my father. And I want to kind of just put it out there about how beneficial it is when a father is present in not his only just his child's life, but a black daughter's life.
Amen to that.
So I want to say, give you guys a good background. My dad came into my life when I was
seven.
I don't know, it feels like forever, but he came into my life when I was seven. And even at 7 years old, I was like, this is my dad. Of course, you know, at first when him and my mom were dating, I called him by his name. But I don't know, how long was it before I was like crying to you, like, can I call you daddy? So ever since then, you know, we just had a great relationship. But did my dad know how it was to be a black father to a black daughter? Because he had sons and he was leading them into growing up to be great black men. So how does a father who had no idea he would be the father of a daughter process that and begin to set the example? And I let him chime in on how he did that.
It's all by a process of elimination. You just do what you do what you do. I was brought up by a strong black mother, single mom. I was in the house with my mother, my sister upstairs with me, and downstairs, it was a two-family house, was my aunt and my grandmother. So me being the only male in the house, I had a lot of respect for women as I grew up. So just watching the way that they moved, it was the way that I wanted my children to move as they got older. So I just tried to emulate what my mother did, because my mother was a fantastic parent. God bless her soul.
Yes, she was. Yes, she was. That was my Nana, and my Nana missed her so, but she ain't playing no games at all. She was a no-nonsense type of woman.
That's for sure.
And my mom is a no-nonsense type of woman. So, therefore, being led by a strong black woman was always ingrained in my DNA, but then when my dad came along, it set like a whole new standard. For me, growing up, it just like my whole logic shifted to where it was like, I don't want to disappoint my dad. My dad can testify to you. I can bring home a C. I was going to burst out crying right in front of him. I cried for everything, because the worst thing for me was my dad being mad at me. Even my mom could like attest to you guys. I was always like, is that okay? Is he mad at me? Did I do anything? No, I didn't do nothing. But that's my codependency, which is for another episode. We'll talk about codependency. But, you know, always making sure that I didn't disappoint him was something that was really big for me. So in growing up, I will say, did I try to look for my dad in relationships? I did, and then I didn't. And that's where I kind of realized, like, all right, you need to start talking to your dad more. Stop always, you know, shelling up and thinking like, oh, I can't talk to my dad about certain things. And that's where right now in 2020, our relationship has blossomed. There's transparency in our relationship. I think there's nothing that I can say to my dad where he'll look at me like, what did you just say? Like, they know I really don't have a filter. I say, if I think it, I'm saying it. And that's what, you know, that's what happened. So I always, you know, just speak my mind now to my dad. And that's one of the things now where I speak to him about my blog before I started it. I was like, Dad, I'm going to be talking about this, and that. He was just like, okay, go for it. And that's like really important to me, because if I know I got my dad behind me, I know I got my mom behind me, I don't care. Y'all can't tell me nothing. Paul and Tina said it's okay, so we going to do it. So transparency. I really feel that fathers and daughters should have transparency. My dad never was really strict with me. I just already knew what it was, like who I could bring home or who I could not bring home. But I can say growing up, my dad never said to me, you can no longer see him, you can no longer date him. He just gave me his opinion, and his opinion mattered so much to me where I was just like, yeah, it's not going to work then if Paul don't like you. So,
Excuse the squeaking in the background.
It's my puppy. Which is his grand puppy.
He's doing his thing.
He's 5 months and he's teething, so. But I would say transparency and patience is something that he's always exhumed. And that was really important with somebody like me. I don't want to say I was a rebellious daughter. Was I rebellious?
No. You like to fight, though.
Didn't know we were going to talk about that on camera.
She's a very strong-willed young lady. And like she said, she has no filter. And she ain't afraid to knuckle up and do what she got to do. But
I've grown. I've grown.
We all have grown.
I haven't been in any trouble in a very long time. And we know what they say. You know, Kelly from Insecure said that's called growth. But I'm very passionate, I can say. I'm very passionate about something I feel about. And father-daughter relationships are really important to me, especially within the black community. I am very passionate about black mental health, because black mental health matters. And in this, I say, a few years ago, I recently came out to my parents, let them know that I have been dealing with depression and anxiety. And even so, there were some things that came with that that was heavy, and I had to talk to him about that and say, you know, I dealt with these feelings and those type of thoughts and things like that. And, you know, in our community, we don't really talk about mental health like that.
Sure don't.
We're quick to tell our children or our counterparts, or our friends, or, you know, anybody in the family, ain't nothing wrong with you. You know, that's just crazy Uncle Joe or whatever. That's, you know, this person and that person, not really taking seriously that this person is suffering from something. So in that, the way I handle with my mental health is my blog, and I reach out to others, and I'm a therapist. I work with victims of domestic violence, sexual assault, human trafficking, and I also work with youth aging out of foster care. in that, we're good. Okay. And in that, you know, I also just mentor to my friends. I give advice. And now in life right now, I really do just have those open talks with my parents, especially my dad. You know, I'm recently getting out of a situation to where I usually would call my mom, because my mom's my best friend, but in this, I called my dad. I said, Dad, this is happening. I don't know what to do. And the first thing he told me was, come home. And here I am. I don't live here, though. I mean, I'm just home. But I feel like I'm rambling. I'm talking a lot. So, you know, we're going to let this amazing black father talk some more about how he came about to raising this lovely black woman you see standing here before you today.
That you are. The main thing I can say is, with your kids don't do what you say. They do what they see you do. So the main thing is that you have to set the example. And I try to set the example by doing what I'm supposed to do, by doing what is respectable at all times, you know. And I try to teach them that they need to respect themselves also. Because if you don't respect yourself, then nobody else is going to respect you. So I try to keep that perspective with them. And hopefully it rubs off, you know. But, you know, everybody goes their own path, their own way. And you have to have faith in them that whatever you have instilled in them is going to kick in eventually at some time. And I can say that she's a very mature young lady. She's taking care of herself. And she loves herself. And hopefully I have set the example of what a good father and a good husband is supposed to be, because that's what I try to do. That's it.
Yeah, so, you know, if you ain't coming like Paul coming, I mean, you know, ain't nothing to talk about. Know what I mean? Because one thing he forgot to say, on top of being a great father and a good husband, this is a great black man. And I look forward to marrying and being with a great black man and building a family with a great black man who set the example, like my father sets the example for me. And I'm an only girl, so as you can see, this
Spoiled.
A little spoiled. But I pay them back with so much appreciation.
Okay. I'm going to drain these oxtails now. Make sure we can get as much water off of them as possible.
Yes, because wet oxtails don't really cook over well.
And I'm going to put...
Bear with me. I'm going to bring the camera closer so you guys can see.
Some garlic powder.
And we're zooming in. Zoom, 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 zoom. Here we go.
Some onion powder. And you see, I just poured into the top. And then...
They know black folk don't measure.
Yeah. That's about 2 teaspoons. Some paprika. For some color. Some pepper.
Notice that was a pinch.
And some salt. And if you have seasoned salt, that's fine too. But I've been trying to do the kosher salt. A little olive oil. And you gotta get your hand in there and get all of this seasoning over all of those oxtails. And we're going to allow them to marinate for a couple of minutes. You usually want them to marinate for at least an hour or so in order to make sure that they get all of the flavor that your seasonings are giving you. Now I'm going to wash my hands.
Let's get a nice cool shot of the seasoning on those bad boys. Yes.
And we'll be back.
Right after.
All right, you two. We're going to heat our pan up. One ingredient that I forgot to tell you about is, anytime you want to cook your meat, you want to make sure that it's brown. You don't want gray meat. So true. You want to make sure that it's brown. And in order to help it brown, you need a little bit of light brown sugar. And you have to keep an eye on this to make sure that it doesn't burn. Burn means bitter. So your olive oil and your light brown sugar on just a medium heat. And just allow it to melt down a little bit. And what we're going to do is we're going to put our oxtails in here and allow them to brown up. And as they brown up, we're going to put them into our Instant Pot, because we usually do this in a slow cooker, but it's going to take 8 hours for the meat to cook.
And we hungry.
So if we put it in an Instant Pot, we could be eating in 2 hours. All right, we'll be right back. Hey, YouTube. Our brown sugar is starting to liquefy a little bit. We don't want it to turn into caramel before we get the oxtails in. So we start cooking the oxtails. Ooh, yeah, buddy. That's the sound you want to hear. Yes, sir. That's good enough, because you don't want to overcrowd your pan. So we're going to allow these to brown up, and we'll be back. Okay, you two. As we start to turn these over, you see they're nice, starting to brown nicely. One question that I get is, will the brown sugar make them sweet? No, it won't. All it does is it causes caramelization on the meat. And you're only putting the sugar in for the first batch. It stays in there for the rest of the batches. And of course, you got the fat rendering down. And that's going to make sure that the pot stays good. And we'll be back. Okay, we're back. Just want to show you what the other side looks like on these oxtails before we stick them into our Instant Pot. And you see all of this is flavor. That's all flavor bits right there. So we're going to take our Instant Pot. We're going to put these inside our Instant Pot. Pot. Now, I know there's some people saying, well, you can cook in the Instant Pot. I don't like doing that. I like doing exactly what I'm doing here, because there's not enough space inside that Instant Pot to do what I need to do. Turn this fire down a little bit. We want to make sure we don't burn up all our seasoning in there. Mm-hmm. On your second batch, if you notice the pot is starting to get brown, turn your fire down some. You want to save all those savory bits in the bottom of the pan. We're going to get all those up later on. And we will be right back. Okay, YouTube. Now, when I was a kid, I thought that that pot was dirty. That's all flavor on the bottom of that pot right there. And what you're going to do, you're going to turn your fire back on. You're going to take your onions, throw your onions in. You take your mushrooms, throw them in. You take your red and your green peppers, toss them in. You're going to hold off on your garlic for right now. You're going to take a wooden spoon. Get yourself a wooden spoon. And you're going to let the wooden spoon do the work. And as these vegetables, the garlic, the onion, the mushrooms start to cook, they release water. And that release, the water that they release is going to start releasing all these bits of flavor that's on the bottom of this pot. So you're going to let this cook for a couple of minutes. And of course, it doesn't have any flavor with it, so you want to put some salt in there. And put some pepper in there. Granulated garlic. Not too much, about a teaspoon or a tablespoon maybe. Granulated onion, same thing, about a tablespoon. And some of that paprika for some more color, about a teaspoon of that. You're going to allow all of this to start cooking up. You see how it's moving all that stuff off the bottom of that pot? We're going to allow this to cook down. And once it cooks down, the bottom of that pot will be clean. Mm-hmm. We'll be back. Okay, it's been about 3-4 minutes since it's been cooking, as you can see. The onions are getting soft and translucent. The mushrooms are starting to darken up. Red peppers and the green peppers are softening up. Now what we're going to do is we're going to make a little space in the middle. My baby girl going to put the garlic in there. You don't want the garlic to cook for too long. You just want it to start smelling. When you start smelling the garlic, the bouquet, and you know you're good. You only want this cooking for about another minute or so. But as you can see on the bottom, all those flavor bits, they're gone. Okay? That pan is clean because all of those bits of flavor is on each piece of this, these vegetables. It's on the mushrooms, it's in the onions. You're good to go. Let this cook down for about a minute, and that's going to go into the Instant Pot with the rest of our stuff, and we're just about ready to go. We'll be right back. Okay, YouTube, we're taking our onions and mushrooms and peppers and garlic. We're putting it in the pot with our oxtails. And it's at this point that I used to tell you, get some bouillon cubes. But bouillon cubes, actually, they have a lot of salt in them. So I started going with some organic broth, trying to get a little bit more healthy. So I poured the broth in there, and that's to clean out the rest of the bits there, trying to clean out the pan as much as I can. Stir this around, so it can get all those bits of flavor. And now this goes into the Instant Pot. Like so. And if you want to come over and take a look. We got our oxtails in there, our peppers and onions and garlic and everything. And as you can see, hopefully you can see it, I'm gonna move some of the oxtails out of the way so you can see how much liquid we got going on in there. All right. And what we're gonna do is, if we were in a crock pot, this would take 8 hours for that to get soft enough for us to eat it. 8 to 10 hours. But we put it in our Instant Pot, we seal it, hit manual, and we're gonna go for an hour. And then we're gonna have to let it release naturally, which means we're gonna let the steam release on its own. And once that is done, we should be ready to get eaten for real. We'll be back. All right, YouTube, just to let you know what's happening. The Instant Pot has this little red button in the back. And once it builds up pressure, that button pops up. And that means all of the pressure is inside of the pot as of right now. If I was to take something and touch that button, you see all of that pressure, that steam coming out of there? That's what you want to stay in there, and that's going to keep that cooking. We also got some water boiling, and we got some sweet corn on the cob that's going to be going. You want something to go with those oxtails, and we figured it's going to be a nice gravy that goes with that. So we have some flat noodles that we have. So we're going to put some flat noodles. Now, always when you do your pasta, I don't know if you can see it, in the water, we salt our water. Why do you salt your water? Because pasta has no flavor. So in order to infuse flavor into the pasta, you salt the water. Okay? Also with the corn has no flavor. Well, it has flavor, but it doesn't have the flavor that we want it to have. So we salt the water for the corn also. And these are the noodles that I went with. Puglia, 100% Puglia. I don't know, it's some kind of Italian noodle, but it's flat. And that's what I wanted. I wanted something with a nice surface area so that when the gravy is on it, you can pick up a lot of gravy with that. So this is what we're doing, and we will be back. Okay, YouTube, we've been cooking for 1 hour in the Instant Pot. We let it natural release. Took 37 minutes for the red dot to go down in the back there. I'm sure the red dot. Okay, it's down flush now. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna open it up. Oof. I wish you could smell it in here. Alright, stand them up. Look at them things falling off the bone. Oh my goodness. This would take 8 hours to happen if we was going in a slow cooker. But look at that. That is beautiful. And what we want to do is we want to thicken that sauce up a little bit. So we're going to turn the Instant Pot off. We're going to put it on saute. And then that'll heat up the liquid inside there. We're gonna get some cornstarch. Cornstarch with cold water. And that's gonna thicken that sauce up. I'm A little cold water. See that? Get the cornstarch. Nice heaping tablespoon of cornstarch. Put it in the cold water. And let that dissolve in the cold water. And once that dissolves in that cold water, we're gonna pour this into the pot and it's gonna thicken up that sauce. See how it's getting all off that spoon there? That's what you want. If you can see inside the pot, because I put it on saute, that's starting to boil a little bit. Pour this cornstarch slurry into the pot. And then start stirring it. And as we stir, that gravy in there is going to thicken up. Tender. Try that sauce one more time.
Okay. Yeah. Is it ready yet?
It's ready. And we wanted that sauce to thicken up because we got some flat noodles. Okay, so we can put that as a bed, put the oxtails over that, and we got some corn on the cob. Just a little something on a Saturday night in the kitchen with Paul. You know how we do.
What, what?
So juicy and tender. Ooh. And the gravy.
And if you don't know, now you know.
Don't forget to subscribe to my channel. I'm so thankful for the subscribers that we have. Thank you, thank you, thank you for subscribing. And once you subscribe, don't forget to click that bell. That bell that you click is going to let you know each and every time that In the Kitchen with Paul is back again doing our thing, doing another recipe for you. So, three things that I always tell you. Number one, always keep God first and foremost in your life. Number two, you got to love your family. And number three, you don't do nothing else. Love yourself. You've been in the kitchen with Paul. Me, I'm Paul. Peace, y'all.